Imagine causing a sinkhole that collapses the Washington Monument. That nightmare scenario haunted the team excavating the 75-foot-deep site for the National Museum of African American History and Culture after they accidentally hit the aquifer under the National Mall. If too much water gushed into their giant pit, they could destabilize their neighbor, the great structure just a few hundred feet away, causing it to shift or even fall over. So they acted quickly to pump water back in to stabilize it. When their instruments showed the ground pressure holding firm, they plugged up the leak and focused on modifying the museum's design to mitigate this new risk. To maximize its exhibit space, while limiting its above-ground footprint, the museum's first four levels are underground. To keep them dry, visitors safe, and the 91,000-ton monument next door standing tall, they encased the subterranean levels in two walls, with 8 feet of porous stone fill in between to catch and hold any water that might penetrate the foundation. It was an ingenious solution, but for builders in the Federal District of Columbia, dealing with a shallow water table is nothing new. When President George Washington chose this idyllic spot to be the national capital, it was a land of farms and woods, rich with surface water. Small brooks trickled into streams, like Rock Creek. Marshes and tidal flats swelled and receded as the 14,700 square mile Potomac Basin drained through the district and mixed with the tidal flow of the Chesapeake Bay, the largest estuary in the United States. But as the city's boulevards and grand buildings were constructed over nearly 2.5 centuries, 70% of these natural streams have disappeared, diverted into sewers, culverts, or filled in and paved over. Tiber Creek flowed through what has become the National Mall. First, it was converted into a canal, and then piped into sewers buried beneath Federal Triangle. Today, this group of large neoclassical buildings between Constitution and Pennsylvania Avenues is home to numerous large government agencies. It's also the lowest point in downtown. In 2006, it rained heavily for an entire week, leaving the triangle submerged, causing tens of millions of dollars in damage and disrupting government operations. It wasn't the first time this had happened here. Experts fear the most extreme storm would put the American History Museum under 16 feet of water. Engineers have taken steps to protect the buildings, like installing temporary barriers, retractable gates, and raising core utilities out of their basements. There's even a temporary levee that's trucked over and dropped in along the mall for added protection ahead of big storms. But throughout the rest of DC, an estimated 16,000 homes and businesses have had little protection from flooding when it rains. Some residents have water gush in from the street, others confront it bubbling up from their toilets when old sewers overflow and long-buried zombie streams gurgle back to life. On the southernmost edge of the district, along the Potomac, another major flooding threat looms. Over the past century, the water line has effectively risen 4 feet, a combination of sea level rise and the land sinking under the weight of development.
I've definitely noticed the water getting a little higher every year.
The area where the water is actually a portion of the seawall that has settled over the years.
During high tide, when the ocean pushes the Chesapeake Bay further up the Potomac, 250 million gallons of river water enter the tidal basin. But it was constructed in 1897 and can no longer contain the river at high tide, causing the walking paths around the monuments and iconic cherry trees to flood twice a day like clockwork.
It's only going to get worse.
Catherine Malone France's organization has worked with landscape architects to reimagine the mall for the future, when there will be even more water.
The status quo is not acceptable here for a place this beloved and this significant.
This advocacy is paying off. Work has begun on the largest design-build contract in the history of the National Park Service, on a new seawall and upgraded shoreline.
This will create the historic distance we've had from the top of the seawalls to the water so that that flooding stops. As part of that, we're going to add a much wider walkway in those sections.
But by far the most advanced large-scale solution is the district's nearly complete network of miles of water storage tunnels. With a diameter greater than the tube of the metro, this system is capable of holding and moving hundreds of millions of gallons of stormwater and sewage overflow to the world's largest advanced wastewater treatment plant, which features the additional purifying steps of nitrification, denitrification, filtration, and disinfection to produce incredibly clean water for release into the Potomac. The machines doing the digging are some of the most impressive tools in modern city building. DC Water explained how theirs, nicknamed Ladybird, works.
Like a determined inchworm, she moves forward in slow, measured movements as her cutter head churns through the Potomac clay. She completes a 6-foot push forward every 18 minutes, then stops for the next cycle. That's where those concrete segments come in. It takes 7 segments to complete each ring of the tunnel. And for every 6 feet she mines, there is 120 cubic yards of material, the muck, that needs to be removed.
The Northeast Boundary Tunnel was completed last year. In its first major storm, it captured 267 million gallons of stormwater and sewage, preventing it from overflowing into streets, homes, and the rivers.
It's a win for all the neighbors and all the citizens up in the northeast part of the district who have experienced flooding for years and years. We're solving that problem.
The final phase of the plan is now underway. A 5.5-mile long tunnel between the mall and the Potomac, and then under the river to Blue Plains. Before the project, an average of 3 billion gallons of combined untreated storm runoff and sewage would overflow into the rivers on the average year, across 82 different events. But when the project's complete, it's expected to happen just 4 times a year. People are getting excited for cleaner rivers.
It makes my heart so happy that we are building these tunnels to kind of curve that runoff going into the streams.
The biggest takeaway is that DC has had a swim and fishing ban for decades. And if the projected goal of, I think, 2025 or 2030 to get the Potomac and Anacostia swimmable and fishable is going to happen, big projects like this need to happen. So this is a huge step in the right direction.
As storms intensify in the years ahead, many cities less wealthy than the capital of the richest country on Earth will face the spending trade-offs that come with building such expensive water infrastructure. And officials in DC will learn whether what they've done is enough.